Hey, I'm Lucas. Welcome to the SpaceX community. Let's get started.
The early morning of November 21st marked a significant moment in SpaceX's ongoing Starship development effort. After Superheavy Booster 18, the first Block 3 booster, experienced a major structural rupture during an ambient temperature pressure test at the Massiey test site in South Texas. Here, I'll go more in depth into the event itself, what is known about the failure, the Block 3 design changes that may have contributed, and how this impacts the path toward Starship Flight 12 and the broader development timeline. Booster 18 had only recently moved out of the production bays and was beginning its qualification test series, representing the next major evolution of the Super Heavy architecture. The Block 3 upgrades include taller propellant tanks, allowing more methane and oxygen volume, thinner stainless steel barrel sections to reduce dry mass, additional plumbing changes for higher flow rates, a fully integrated hot staging ring, enlarged grid fins for improved aerodynamic control, and revised aft suction routing designed for future Raptor iterations. Together, these changes were intended to increase total thrust capability, raise propellant margins, and enable more aggressive recovery profiles later in the program. Before moving to cryogenic proof testing, SpaceX routinely performs an ambient pressure test using gaseous nitrogen to confirm the vehicle's basic structural soundness, plumbing integrity, and venting system response. During such tests, the tanks are gradually brought up to moderate pressures using room temperature nitrogen, checking for leaks, verifying valve sequencing, and ensuring overall structural compliance before subjecting the booster to the far more extreme loads of sub-zero cryogenic fills. Shortly after midnight, Booster 18 entered this test phase, and sensors were tracking pressure gradients, strain levels, and valve behavior. For several minutes, the procedure appeared nominal. Then, unexpectedly, high-speed camera footage captured a sudden rupture originating along the lower section of the liquid oxygen tank. Within a fraction of a second, a vertical tear propagated upward along the barrel, peeling back a substantial sheet of stainless steel and causing the adjacent rings to collapse inward. A large plume of gaseous nitrogen vented outward as the tank depressurized. No fire occurred, and no personnel were at risk, since the booster contained no liquid methane or liquid oxygen and had no engines installed. The booster remained upright on the test stand, and the upper methane tank and internal transfer tube continued supporting their loads, which provided valuable insight into the overall structural framework's resilience, even under catastrophic lower tank failure. Early visual analysis of the footage, along with the location and shape of the rupture, strongly suggests the underlying cause was an overpressurization event confined to the oxygen section. At ambient temperature, the stainless steel used on Starship hardware has lower yield strength compared to cryogenic conditions, where the metal stiffens substantially. Since Block 3 tank walls are thinner for mass savings, this reduces burst margins even further during non-cryogenic tests, making the tanks more sensitive to pressure imbalances. Several potential pathways for overpressurization fit the observed damage pattern. The first involves the redesigned dual fill and drain system introduced for Block 3, which uses new quick disconnect interfaces and revised valve sequences intended to speed up ground operations. A mistimed valve, partial vent blockage, or unexpected sequencing during the early part of the test could have allowed nitrogen to accumulate faster than the vent system could relieve it. Another possibility lies within the autogenous pressurization lines. In flight, these lines deliver engine-generated gases to maintain proper ullage pressure, but during ground testing they carry nitrogen for verification. These lines interface directly through the LOX tank wall using manifolds and weldments that may have been altered under the Block 3 routing scheme. Any obstruction in these lines, or a flaw in their mounting, could produce localized pressure spikes that escalate quickly. The similarity to earlier pressure-related failures, including SN3 and SN4 in 2020, supports the theory that minor valve or sequencing malfunctions can rapidly exceed tank tolerances when margins are tight. While some observers pointed to other hardware, such as COPVs inside the lock section, or auxiliary tanks reportedly included for extended on-pad operations, the uniform nature of the rupture, vertical, smooth, and involving a large swath of the barrel, argues against a concentrated point source failure. COPV bursts leave highly localized damage and typically cause fragmentary debris, neither of which appear present here. The transfer tube, a key structural component running vertically through the booster, remained intact, suggesting it did not induce the failure. Whatever the exact root cause, SpaceX responded quickly and transparently, confirming only hours later that the booster experienced an anomaly during gas system pressure testing, and emphasizing the absence of any propellants or engines. Investigators immediately began reviewing telemetry, pressure trace, valve logs, and high-speed video to reconstruct the sequence leading up to the rupture. As with previous Starship development anomalies, the data derived from this event may prove more valuable than the hardware itself. Embedded strain gauges and pressure sensors will provide detailed information about exactly when the tank moved beyond its elastic range, how the fracture propagated through the rings, and where structural reinforcement or procedural modifications may be required. This is critical as Block 3 boosters push into new mass-optimized territory where tank walls are thinner, operational pressures are higher, and venting architecture is more complex than in earlier generations. However, this incident has direct schedule implications. Booster 18 was expected to support Starship Flight 12, which SpaceX leadership previously targeted for early 2026. Flight 12 is planned to demonstrate several essential elements for upcoming missions: improved ascent performance under Block 3's higher thrust potential, refined hot staging behavior, better boostback control authority, and, potentially, an early tower catch attempt, depending on regulatory conditions. With Booster 18 now unable to fly, its replacement, likely Booster 19, will need to complete stacking, integration, ambient testing, and cryogenic proofing before SpaceX can resume launch preparations. Depending on whether the investigation results mandate design changes, such as thicker tank rings, modified vent paths, or updated pressurization logic, Booster 19's testing could be delayed by several weeks or even months. For SpaceX, which relies on rapid iteration, this is a normal part of the development cycle, but it still slows the timeline toward the first fully reusable operational Starship flights. From a broader perspective, this impacts NASA's Artemis schedule as well. Starship's human landing system variant depends heavily on Block 3's capabilities, particularly in areas such as propellant capacity, thrust margins, and orbital refueling efficiency. Flight 12 is expected to provide a significant amount of data relevant to future HLS missions, including testing hot staging ring loads, ascent dynamics under higher thrust, and tank behavior under extended coast phases. NASA already considers the timeline for Artemis 3, nominally targeting mid-2027, to be under pressure due to the complexity of the refueling and tanker deployment sequence. A several-month slip in Flight 12 could ripple into later milestones, such as cryogenic transfer demos and depot-based refueling tests. Despite these challenges, the controlled nature of the failure avoids more severe consequences. Because no cryogenic propellant was present, and the anomaly occurred during ground testing, the launch infrastructure at Starbase remains unharmed. This means no extended pad repairs or facility downtime will be required. Additionally, conducting these tests early in the Block 3 flow allows SpaceX to incorporate corrective measures before mass production ramps up for later boosters and ships. As teams begin removing Booster 18 from the stand and preparing the area for cleanup, fabrication work inside the production bays continues. Multiple other boosters and ships are already in various stages of construction, allowing SpaceX to redirect resources quickly once the investigation concludes. While Flight 12's schedule will adjust, future missions and hardware lines can adapt to the updated design requirements without halting overall production momentum. In the coming weeks, more information will likely emerge on the specific components involved, whether procedural changes are needed for ambient pressure tests, and how upcoming Block 3 vehicles will be modified. For now, the failure marks another data point in the iterative Starship roadmap, offering insights that will help refine the vehicle ahead of more demanding full-stack flights.
Thanks for watching today's episode. Don't forget to subscribe and give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Stay tuned for another great video tomorrow.